Hey, what's up, world? I'm Sway, and this is what people love about hip-hop. It's the bravado-fueled tradition of MCs battling it out with words. It's been a part of the tradition of hip-hop since day one, and it's what helps sets rap apart from other forms of music. So whether you're a hip-hopper, a sports fan, or a pro wrestling fan, everybody loves a good grudge match. And for the next half an hour, we're going to take a look at one that's turning out to be a classic. Now, since September the 11th, New York has been in a pretty strange place. And now there's finally signs that everything is getting back to normal. People are free to feud again, like the war of words between two of the city's biggest music stars, the king of Brooklyn's Marcy Projects, Jay-Z, versus the poet of Queensbridge, Nas. Now, it's a battle that's the latest in the tried and true tradition of hip-hop, and as you're about to see, as competition often does, it brought out the best lyrically between Nas and Jay-Z.
It's a ill lyrically war right now.
I think Jay on top right now.
I like to hear some more.
Eat the joint. He straight killed Jay-Z on that one.
Hold up. Just how did this legendary battle erupt? The fuse was lit at New York's radio station, Hot 97's 2001 Summer Jam. The long festering rivalry between Jay-Z's Rockefeller camp and QB's Finest blew up on stage when Jay debuted The Takeover.
He starts doing the Takeover. No one knew what that song was, all right? He does the first verse, The Takeover. You hear the background, the little Jim Morrison Doors sample.
Come on!
Dum, dum, ba, dum, do. Everyone's like, okay, but they're listening to him.
I don't care if you mob people, I hold truths. You little I got money stacks bigger than you.
He had the verse that dissed Prodigy. So he said that verse and tried to clown him, and the crowd loved it.
But then at the end of the line, he goes, ask Nas, he don't want it with Ho.
Ask Nas, he don't want it with Ho.
No. Crowd went crazy, like, whoa, wait a minute. Oh, it's like, okay, now it's on.
At that point, Jay-Z finally acknowledged that he doesn't like Nas, that there's a conflict with Nas, and he said it.
Nah, I wasn't surprised by Jay at the Summer Jam. He knew that this is a point in his life where he can make himself official. That was a big step for hip hop, no matter who he dissed or whatever. And that's good.
Good, but not over.
Boom. About 3 weeks later, Nas drops a beautiful freestyle called Stillmatic.
With the release of Stillmatic on mixtapes, Nas took his argument back to the streets.
H to the Izzo, M to the Izzo, push Izzo, you phony, the rapper version of Cisco.
When Jay did the Summer Jam, you know, everybody's in the streets is like, yo, I know you're gonna get at him, so I got at him with the freestyle joint.
Your fake rhymes and no times that never took place, you liar. Un was your first court case, you had no prize.
I'm sorry, it was that small, but he touched the nerve.
Although it was a stinging track, Stillmatic failed to create a buzz. When Takeover was released on Jay's Blueprint album, his new verse responded to Stillmatic and made the opening blow at Summer Jam seem like a tap.
Had a spark when you started, but now you're just garbage. Fell from top 10 to not mention at all.
He comes at Nas hard from all angles. He comes at it from the perspective of, like, from a fan, kind of. Like, you know, like, your last album was, he broke it down, how Nas fell off.
If I was to get at somebody on that level, I gotta make sure I come with my best.
Smart enough, Nas, 4 albums in 10 years, I could divide, that's one that be, let's say two. Two of them was due. One was Nas, the other was Illmatic. That's a one hot album, every 10-year average, and that's so.
I'm not being lazy with it, I'm not playing around with it, I'm gonna really, I'm gonna do my research and I'm gonna come back with something real serious, you know what I'm saying? And it's gonna be hot.
I'm sorry, but anyone that heard that knew that it was like, oh, that's it, that's a rap, Nas is out of here.
In the very beginning, when I heard Takeover, I personally didn't think Nas could come back.
But Nas was far from KO'd.
You a fan, a phony, a fake, a you stand, I still whip your ass.
And I knew that eventually people want to hear what I gotta say.
Were you abused as a child, scared to smile, they called you ugly?
Addressing it right so I could let them know it's not happening. It is no takeover.
No takeover, but there was an invasion as Nas's response song, Ether, spread through the underground via New York mixtape king, K Slay.
Put Ether on the tape, and it just went wild.
It was a spanking. People didn't expect that. No one expected Nas to come back.
I am the truest. Name a rapper that I ain't influenced.
After the Ether, that's it. New York was on Nas's back. People who were Jay-Z fans on Friday were Nas fans on Saturday.
And by December 11, 2001, the battle was blazing. A week before Nas' Stillmatic LP and Jay-Z's Unplugged albums were set for a head-to-head release, the two MCs would be drawn into a battle of the beats on a New York radio show.
Hot 97, blazing hip-hop and R&B.
Hot 97 has this exclusive Jay-Z song, Super Ugly, that's a response to Ether. Nobody's heard it, hasn't been on any mixtapes. They're gonna play it on the radio for the first time. So it becomes like a big event.
Jay-Z's response today at 3 o'clock, tune in, it is on.
And the whole city shuts down.
If you was in New York at 3 o'clock on that day, you had to tune on the Hot 97.
The anticipation is big.
A few minutes after 3 o'clock, you know, we hear the response.
Damn, I'm only worth over 100 million. Look, I got beef with like 100 children.
Unfortunately, it wasn't up to par.
Super ugly.
Jay-Z said it was just a freestyle. It wasn't an answer to Ether. So the last person in the world, I'm going to underestimate Jay-Z.
You have to feel like the battle really isn't over. It doesn't seem like there's a finale there.
This is hip-hop in its purest form.
Rap is a competitive sport. That's how we build it.
And it's always going to be a battle about who's the greatest.
Now, another result from the back and forth between Nas and Jay-Z is that it shook things up a little bit. It added a breath of fresh air to what, for the first part of 2001, had been a fairly flat year for hip-hop. But what that meant is that the battle captured the attention of rap fans and hip-hoppers everywhere.
I think this may go down as one of the greatest battles of all time.
I know kids come into stores like this, juiced about verses that they've heard battling against who, this guy battled this guy, and they come in fired up because these cats are battling.
Two of the greatest rappers battle each other, and people get excited of music like that.
It's hot, man. That's what hip-hop need that, you know what I mean? That's one of the essence of rap. You know, the battle.
Joe, we need some fun in this, man. Back in the days, you know what I mean? You had Kane doing it. You know what I mean? You had L doing it.
That's how it all started. Different crews battling against each other. And that was kind of like the essence of it. You know, who had the better skills, the better lyrics. You know, who was the best crew.
It's amusing. It makes people laugh. It sells records. So it's good in that sense.
Martin Luther King said, talk it out. We just making it rap. We just making the lines rhyme.
And Nas is very creative and Jay is creative. But, you know, it all depends on when the battle is won, who's the last man standing. Uh-huh. And, you know, right now, everybody's standing.
Nas and Jay-Z have had a lot to say in this battle, but are their claims true? Right after this break, we're gonna read between the lines and try to figure out who's got the facts right and who doesn't. Welcome back, glad you're still with us. MTV News Now special report, taking a look at Jay-Z and Nas and their battle for lyrical supremacy. Now, as we saw earlier, the war of words between these two rappers really seemed to take off when Jay-Z performed the line from the song Takeover back in June at a New York radio station Summer Jam concert. But the artistic battle traces back to Rockefeller artist Memphis Bleek's debut album. On his first album, Coming of Age, Jay's protege, Memphis Bleek, released a song featuring a verse from Jigga.
Jay put a verse on one of my records, on my album, What You Think of That?
What You Think of That?
And the hooks blatantly say, I'm a ball till I fall, what you think of that?
I'm a ball till I fall, what you think of that?
Now that track, for some reason, struck a chord with Nas, prompting the Queensbridge MC to cite Bleek's lyrics in his own song.
You want a ball till you fall, I can help you with that. You want beef, I can let it fucking melt in your hat.
By blatantly referencing Bleek's line in his response, it appeared that Nas was challenging him.
A lot of times rappers listen to other rappers' lyrics and they feel like people coming at them, they're very sensitive and they feel like sometimes rappers are coming at them indirectly.
And rather than a face-to-face confrontation, MCs generally take it straight to the mic. And so, Bleek responded on his single, My Mind Right.
I don't got no personal feeling against the man, like he cool, you know what I'm saying? I ain't got nothing against him, but you throw a line at me, be prepared, I'ma throw one at you.
Your lifestyle's written, so who you supposed to be? Play your position.
And on one of the key lines in that record, he said, your lifestyle's written, well, who you supposed to be? Play your position. And of course, you know, everyone knows Nas' second album was called It Was Written. So people took that as a diss.
Now, by referencing this album title, Bleek let the world know that he was talking about Nas and questioning his credibility. And so it was written, or maybe we should say spoken. The first seed was planted in the battle to come.
This is a rule, though. You're never supposed to let your enemy know what you're thinking. and they did just the opposite, so now I know what they're thinking about, and it's cool.
While Nas's rules may seem like they were lifted from the Art of War manual, the N to the A to the S-I-R soon let Bleak know exactly what he was thinking. The outcome? A sly line on his Queensbridge Finest compilation album.
Oh, you didn't want to know whose life was written, the life I'm living, the ice of women.
Oh, you didn't was Nas's way of coyly dismissing newcomer Memphis Bleak's attack on the veteran MC's image. Things appeared to simmer down in early 2001, but it wouldn't be long until Bleak's mentor, Jay-Z, claimed he was on the wrong end of Nas's bad-mouthing campaign, this time over the radio airwaves in Los Angeles.
It seems to be resolved, but then Jay claims he's in LA and he hears Nas on the radio in LA talking reckless and saying bad things about Jay. So at that point, Jay's like, all right, I'm gonna say something about him. I'm gonna bring it to him.
And Jay did put it all out in the open a few months later when he came at Nas with The Takeover. Now that song plus Nas's No Holds Barred response Ether qualify as two of the best battle records ever made, hands down. But a good diss record is not necessarily a truthful one. I mean, sometimes things get a little exaggerated. So we decided to do a fact check on the claims made by both lyrical warriors.
Went from nasty Nas to Esco's trash. Had a spark when you started, but now you're just garbage.
Claim number one. Jay says Nas has fallen off since his first album in 1994, Illmatic.
That's a one hot album every 10-year average, and that's so.
One hot album every 10 years? Let's take a closer look. Nas's Illmatic was a success with critics, but since then, sales of his albums have dropped, and so has his critical acclaim. Looks like Jay may have a point.
The follow-ups after Illmatic were not on people's radars.
After Illmatic, this guy was looked at as maybe one of the best MCs of all time. Now he's just a guy who makes, you know, some good records, but he's not living up to that promise of that first album.
But Jay's claim may be outdated, since Nas released the appropriately titled Stillmatic on December 18th last year, garnering critical acclaim and impressive first week sales.
It's taking hip-hop back to hip-hop.
I am the truest, name a rapper that I ain't influenced.
And with this new album came acclaim from Nas.
All I did was give you a style for you to run with.
Did Jay take Nas's rhyme style?
Jay-Z used to rhyme differently. He used to rhyme a faster rhyme style.
Well, check out the J, check out the A, check out the Y, Z.
They had a really faster rhyme style, like more similar to the quick tongue rhyme style, which was really prominent in the early 90s.
Over time, Jay-Z may have switched up his rhyme skills.
I'm sick with the flow and this is all I know.
Though it's impossible to prove whether it was an evolution of his personal style or a robbery of Nas. But there is one thing that he did borrow from the Queensbridge rapper. Who did Jay sample on his first hit, Dead Presidents? You guessed it, none other than Nas.
I'm out for presidents to represent me. Say what?
I'm out for dead presidents to represent me.
Well, spit that.
Even Jigga himself admits to taking it, but he also admits to perfecting it.
Yeah, I sampled your voice, you was using it wrong. You made it a hot line, I made it a hot song.
Whether or not he made it a hotter song, they're both classics.
Speaking of classics, let's check up on another one of Nas's claims in this battle. Nas also points out that Jay takes lyrics from the late great Notorious B.I.G.
How much of Biggie's rhymes is gonna come out your fat lips?
Well, Jay did use some lines from Biggie.
When the Remy's in the system,
ain't no telling, will I fuck him, will I diss him?
Jigga probably wouldn't deny that he's borrowed from Biggie. Nonetheless, most say it's a tribute to his good friend and rhyming partner. But there are some claims Jay is a little more reluctant to take credit for.
You 36 in a karate class, you Tybo.
Though we're not sure if Jay takes Tybo, he does claim to be younger than 36 years old. So this time, Nas scores points for humor. But as any battle MC knows, the truth is what really hurts.
You want to try to be factual because fact is more of a punch than something that can be just written off as a joke.
Well, whosoever side you decide to take in this battle, it has shaped up to be one for the record books, but there have been plenty of others. Right after this break, we'll take a look at rap's biggest and best rhyming battles and consider where this war of words might be headed. Welcome back. Now, the recent verbal sparring between Jay-Z and Nas, as any hip-hop fan is aware, is the latest in rap's long tradition of creative battles. In fact, in the early days, whether it be a DJ, an MC, or a breakdancer, hip-hop has always been driven by competition. actually, rivalry frequently made the performance that much richer, and rappers have often found that some of their best material is the most spontaneous. One of the first battles on Wax to score big in the early 80s started at parties where pioneering rappers Kumo D and Busy B spit verbal disses on the regular.
Come on. Busy B, he would just go from beginning to end, oh, come on, clap your hands, come on, oh. It was always fun to get on and out-rhyme somebody.
You're not number one, you're not even the best, and you can't win no real MC contest.
He snapped on me, he took me to the mud.
Mo D would soon find himself in the battle trenches again as an up-and-coming LL Cool J exchanged words with the now old-school MC.
How you like me now?
How you like me now, punk?
It's like Eddie Murphy and Richard Pryor standing on stage and telling jokes about one another, seeing who can win. It was no hard feelings.
For LL, success in the lyrical ring meant having to defend the title. Subsequent verbal sparring with Ice-T and Hammer proved to be minor compared to a challenge later in his career from freestyle star Cannabis. Fans tuned in like it was a championship bout, and the newcomer was going for no less than a knockout.
Now watch me rip the tap from your arm, kick you in the groin, stick you for your Vanguard award in front of your mom, your first, second, and third born.
I actually laughed. This is not a new thing for me. This is like Michael Jordan going to the finals.
Cannabis, he ain't understanding this, because 99% of his fans don't exist.
I heard the record, you know, it's hip-hop, you know what I mean? Because he's responding, but I think it's garbage.
The nature of hip-hop is competitive anyway. It's a competitive genre. And as long as it stays friendly and people understand the difference between hate and competition, you know, it's really not a problem.
Cannabis's battle with LL eventually marked a high point in his career at a time when platinum hits, not competition, meant success. But back in the day, before rap went pop, battles were the best way for rappers to shine, as witnessed by the classic rivalry between Queens MC Shan and the Bronx KRS-One.
South Bronx, the South, South Bronx.
When I was coming up, you had to go to the club and prove yourself before an audience. And sometimes in proving yourself, you was challenged.
And don't think dissing is strictly an East Coast thing. After NWA broke up, Dr. Dre found greater success with the diss record and video, lampooning former bandmate Eazy-E and Two Live Crew's Luke Campbell.
Yes, my homie Dre can't be touched.
Luke's bending over.
So Luke's getting stuck, buster.
When I saw the video, I laughed. I mean, it was funny.
It's all business, it's all entertainment.
Dissing would stay in Dre's musical family for years to come. After receiving what he perceived to be an insult from Everlast, Dre protege Eminem showed why he earned respect as an underground battle MC long before earning platinum plaques.
They shot you back to life at the clinic, but you about to get relapsed any minute. Honky, I hit him up.
I actually like his new record. I'm like one of the six people that bought it.
What's your candy ass name? You're a candy ass rapper. I'll smack you up, shut you off like the clapper.
The guy runs around and shoots deers in cages like, you know, Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears. I'm not in sync, man.
Of course, maybe the most renowned rivalry in rap history involved fallen icons Tupac and Notorious B.I.G. But ironically, the beef between the two can never be considered a classic rap battle.
There was battles before Tupac and Biggie, and there'll be battles after them.
Mm-hmm.
We hip-hoppers know that Tupac and Biggie was not battling.
Westside, when we rock, I'm equipped with game.
Although Tupac spit flames at Biggie on many occasions, a response track was never released by the Bad Boy star. Despite having undeniable East Coast, West Coast feud as a backdrop, beef between Pac and Biggie was clearly not part of hip-hop's great lyrical tradition. Though there is no evidence linking their untimely and still unresolved deaths to their music, it still begs the notion that artists and their fans have a responsibility to keep these battles strictly on wax, just as Nas and Jay-Z have exemplified.
If you really have a problem, you're not gonna put it on record, so that's why I know it's just music.
It's only music, and you know, we keep it on wax.
So there you have it, bringing us back to where we are today, but where is all of this headed? I mean, was it the last of the battle of rhymes between Jay-Z and Nas, or will some more resurface? Or what about the battles on the horizon? I've heard that we should be on the lookout for the Lox versus Puffy, or for you R&B heads, R. Kelly versus Cisco. But whatever it is, as long as it's kept fun and positive and in the music, lyrical slugfest and competition are what keeps it exciting and interesting. In the meantime, you guys hold your head, keep it righteous, play it safe. My name is Sway, and I'm out.